Quiet.
For coming tonight and not bringing COVID or anything else with you. I'm going to have my mask off so they can see me making faces at them if they miss a note or something. otherwise I would have it on. That was East River March. That's something I wrote because we couldn't come up with a better idea for a fight song. Not all of the notes you heard, though, were things I wrote. The trombones every year seem to add some other, that, they made that up on their own. There's another one that Joe here and some other guys made up several years ago. So they've kind of customized it as they go. This is, of course, Blue Jeans and Bands. We have lots of concerts where we can dress up, clap politely, and listen to music by old dead white people from Europe, which is basically classical music. That's not what this is. This is designed to be low key. If you feel something's worth laughing at, please do so, unless it's one of the notes we played. Don't laugh at that. But enjoy this. Have a good time. Tonight on the program, we have the concert band, and this is an augmented band. I'll tell you about that in a minute. We have our jazz band is going to play, and our guitar ensemble, and our trombone quartet. And for the first time, in all likelihood, the last time in recorded history, we're going to have country music on the stage, or some version of it, on this stage. But hey, I can do whatever I want to do at this point in my life, I'm pretty sure. It's a great feeling. We're going to continue the concert band portion of our opening here with a piece called Winter on Emerald Bay. I do not know where Emerald Bay is. I don't know what's special about winter there, or if it's even a real place. But the theme for this concert tonight is music I like and I just want to do. And that's the honest thing. There's no other connection other than I like this music. And that's really the only reason we need to do anything in the arts, is because it pleases us and makes us happy. We shouldn't have to argue for the arts in society, but we often do. But this is music that makes us happy. And as you listen to it, hopefully you'll hear the same joy that I hear in it.
Thank you.
So does it matter where Emerald Bay is or why winter's important there? No, because that's fun. Speaking of things we do that are we do simply because we enjoy it and for no other reason, there's some cake back there that's not just for me. So when we're done tonight, everyone's invited to come get a piece of the cake. Please don't all mob it at once. I put a flute player in charge, and she is in charge. Do not mess with her, especially James, because he's married to it, okay? So, Winter on Emerald Bay, one of my favorite pieces there. To me, it sounds like a happy Celtic person, the land of happy wars and sad loves, where a dance and a fight might be the same thing, you don't know, but it just sounds like so much fun. Now, we've all had quarantine. We've sat around our houses, sometimes literally watched paint dry. One of the best things, though, is discovering what Netflix and all the streaming services have to offer. And one of the things we discovered was this little green guy with funny ears called Grogu. Baby Yoda. You know the little Baby Yoda memes? His name's not Yoda, but we all call him Baby Yoda. We were watching The Mandalorian. As much of a redneck as I am, I'm also a sci-fi geek. It's an odd combination. I had a TARDIS in my basement until last week, but now she's got it. The Mandalorian is an adventure. In many ways, it's part of the Star Wars universe where they called it a space western. If you think about the old spaghetti westerns and the things you would see in them, the same characters are in things like The Mandalorian. There's good guys, there's bad guys. Instead of a horse, he has a ship that looks like a toaster that flies through space. And he's defending the innocent. It's almost like the Lone Ranger all over again. So tonight we bring you The Mandalorian.
Thank you.
let you move in just a moment. We're going to shift around to become a different ensemble. If the guitar folks want to go ahead and head on up there. This is not just, well, this really isn't the concert band. This was the marching band this spring, which is not what any of us planned on. But like we always do for blue jeans and bands, anything we don't have, we ask people to come and play. Very often we have brought in high school players. How many of you played with us when you were in high school in this Blue Jeans and Bands concert? Okay. See, it's like it's a sneaky recruiting ploy, almost as if that was intentional. Well, this time we brought in alumni. Alumni, stand up. The whole flute song. And we're not done yet, and you know what I'm about to do. Okay. How many band directors are in the group? Raise your hand. Put your hand up, guys. Okay. Now, it gets better. The rest of you, how many of you were at one time students of one of these band directors in high school? And now they're students here. So there are three generations of musicians up here. And that makes me the old guy in the group, right? Okay, we're going to change up now. Concert band, if you guys want to find a seat or a spot to stand somewhere and watch. And we're going to have the guitar ensemble. A number of years ago, over in the fax office, there was this random guy in there talking. I don't remember how I wandered in, but I have a habit of when I see someone I don't know wandering around the chapel, I check just in case there's information I need. And this guy turned out to be a guitar player named Vince Lewis. And he was just wanting to teach a few guitar lessons through our community school. And we got to talking, said, "Oh, you do jazz?" I didn't know who he was. I listen to country music, what do I know? And one thing led to another, and now Vince has led us. We've got a guitar ensemble. We've got a jazz band, and just Tuesday night, we had our first ever guitar major do his guitar recital here. So, we now present to you the guitar ensemble.
All right. Thank you, Charles. Ready? Thank you. musical called Jumbo, probably obviously written about an elephant, and it's entitled My Romance.
Thank you.
see how many instruments they all play. It's incredible. We've been working on a lot of improvisational skills, different styles this semester. We're going to close our short set with a tune like Dr. Priest, Charles. This is one of my favorites. It's a upbeat Larry Carlton tune entitled Small Town Girl.
Thank you.
Frank Shelton, Jacob Brooks, Staley Lyle, James Harris, and fabulous drummer Joshimer McRae, doing all the work out there.
It's a multi-talented group. We have students that they're so talented, we have to be careful that we don't wear them out, because they can play, they can sing, they can do theater. And this is sometimes in addition to what they're actually majoring in. So we have to protect our students, or maybe protect our students from us, from asking too much of them sometimes. This next set we're doing, we've got two pieces. One is called First Suite in E-flat. And the movement is called a Chaconne. I'll tell you about that in a minute. It's by the composer named Gustav Holst. And then a piece called On a Hymn Song of Philip Bliss by David R. Holsinger. Now, a chaconne is a specific kind of music. There's going to be a melody that I'm going to ask a couple of guys to play in just a minute. You're going to hear it 16 times. And each time, it's a little bit different. So here we go. Hey, I need my music for this moment. Entire piece of music is based on that little short melody, and you're going to hear it multiple times throughout this chaconne.
Thank you.
most people that have come into my office have learned that they don't know what to expect when it comes to the music I'm listening to that day. Some days it's bluegrass, some days it's blues guitar, some days it's Indian powwow music because I love that stuff. And it's okay if I'm the only one that does, and I'm fine with that. My basic core identity in music, though, is as a church musician. The first identity I had for myself in church as a child was when I realized as I sang a hymn, during that moment, I was on an equal footing with all the adults in the church, the deacons, my Sunday school teacher, the preacher, everyone there. I was engaged in a sacred action on an equal footing with them. And that's why most of my career has been rooted in church music or teaching at a Christian college. And I've certainly enjoyed 11 years of that. The core of that are the hymns. We're getting ready to do a piece called A Hymn Song of Philip Bliss. We know the hymn as When Peace Like a River Attendeth My Way. It is well with my soul. Has everyone had an enjoyable quarantine? And that was sarcasm. They're used to that. I may have to explain it to you. This has been a miserable experience for us, hasn't it, in many ways. I need to tell you why this is my last concert. My mother almost passed away from COVID in January. And we thought, oh great, she's out of the hospital. And then she nearly died in our arms a second time. And as an only child, I do not belong here, I belong there. And I want to be with my family. Now, it is scary. I'm not sure. My last paycheck is July 31st. I'm not sure what's going to be happening on August 1st. It will probably not involve buying a new car or anything. I'm going to be making less money, and you know, I just don't care. It's not that important to me. My daughter's out of college. We can live without eating out three times a week. You just go twice, you know. But this has been a stressful time for all of us. We've had to make decisions. Some of us have known people that have passed away from this virus that's ravaged our planet. We've seen our country just ripped to shreds by anger and hatred and violence at every turn. And as great as we think our troubles are, it's really pathetic when we think we're having a bad time. The writer of the hymn, When Peace Like a River, was a businessman, and he was planning a trip to Europe. But at the last minute, he got caught up for business, so he sent his wife and his three children ahead on a ship called the Ville de Havre. That's the name of the tune of that hymn, by the way. It's named for the ship, because as it crossed the Atlantic Ocean, it sank. And he got a telegram in New York from his wife saying, safe, alone. And he knew instantly that meant, my wife is alive, my children are gone. So he couldn't just jump on a plane. He could not FaceTime or Zoom with her. He could not call her. He had to get on a ship and cross the Atlantic Ocean himself. And about halfway across, a message came from the captain that said, this is the spot. Nothing more. This is the spot. And he knew at that instant, as he looked over that rail, beneath his feet, somewhere were his children. And that's hard to do. Some of us would just jump off the ship ourselves. Some of us would curse God to his face. Some of us would turn our backs on society. Some of us would become a hollow shell of a human being. Yet he sat down and wrote a poem. When sorrows like sea billows roll, it is well with my soul. And that reminds me, when we're done tonight, what I want a souvenir picture of everyone in the band and everyone that's been a student of mine, even that one. I want to be up here in the middle, and I want you guys around me so I can take a picture if you don't mind. So do it anyway, even if you do mind. Okay, band, go ahead and have a seat. One of the things we do is we take advantage of the students we have. There's a reason we don't have a marching kazoo band, because we don't play kazoo, that and no one wants to listen to it. But we've got a wonderful faculty member, Dr. Andy Necessary. He started the instrumental program here. And then a couple of years later, he moved on and I came, and I've been here for 11 years. And then he came back and he directs the marching band. We help each other. That's only the third time I've told that joke, Andy. Sorry. I won't do it again, I promise. He's a wonderful trombone player, and we've got a good group of trombone players. And Jay up here, you notice he was playing bass guitar earlier, and then he was playing alto saxophone over here, and now he's picking up a trombone. He's not making this up as he goes along. He can play all of those instruments equally well. So here is our trombone quartet.
Thank you.
They played for Honors Convocation yesterday, wasn't it? Yesterday, and they've done some other outreach things for us, so maybe we'll have four trumpets or four something else next year, and we'll add to this. Okay, we're going to change gears again, so now we have to become a jazz band. Some of the same people now have to change their thought process, and instead of playing classical music with fine articulations, we're now playing jazz and channeling our inner rock stars a little bit as well. So bear with us as we shift gears.
The thing about the music business is mostly the thing about the music business, which means you've got to be able to do so many different things. So not only do we have different instrumentals here and different styles, but our students come out, they're comfortable in a classical setting. So it's a little bit of a commercial, but it's true. They come out in a classical setting, they come out in a country setting. Some of the people in this group were not that familiar with big band jazz improvisation before this year, and now they are. And Garrett sees me staring at him. Anyway, the first tune we're going to play is an old big band tune, which was pretty much dance music back in the day, entitled Night Train. Ready? One, four, Z. One, two, one. Thank you. this next tune a little bit calmer. The bossa nova craze hit in the 60s, and most of them were written by Antonio Carlos Jobim, like Girl from Ipanema. This one was not, but it's a great tune, and it's entitled So Nice.
Thank you.
actually my first time in 48 years of university teaching. I've had a department chair who also is a guitarist, which has been a pretty good thing for the last 11 years. Only the past three for me, but 11 for everybody else. This last tune, our clarinet player, who is now our bass player, is going to kick this off. Yeah, there she is. So all the pressure is on her. Not to put any back there, but this is a blues tune written by guitarist Kenny Burrell, and it's a really funky kind of tune featuring everyone soloing on it, and it's called Chitlins Con Carne.
Thank you.
The versatility of the group is one of the things that makes life interesting. Sometimes you can look at the people on stage and you really don't know what kind of music is about to be played because it's the same people every time. They even have weird instruments like what Alexandra is playing back here. That's her bass guitar. It's not a kid's ukulele. That's the bass guitar she's been playing, and there's a bunch of us all want these now just from watching her playing it. Dr. Necessary, where did you go? He's going to come and give us some instructions about how we're going to eat cake in just a few minutes. The part you've all been waiting for, of course. Now, when I came, I was made the director of instrumental studies, meaning if it had strings on it, if you hit it with a stick, if you blow air into it, it was my responsibility to keep them fixed, keep them running, and keep the students being taught and all that. This is now Dr. Necessary's job, so it's all his, and he's going to give you some instructions. You've got the band logo right there. I will certainly miss being here. However, there are some perks with that. Dr. Flowers, I skipped the last faculty meeting. Did you know that? I figured I could get away with it just one time in 11 years of skipping a faculty meeting last week, something like that. There are many things I will miss. Some of the things I've told people, most of what I get paid, my compensation for being here, does not show up on a W-2 form. That does not mean I'm getting cash under the table. I promise you that's not happening. Every day I get to get up and sometimes earlier than I want, but I can look out my office window, and I've always had my chair turned so I can see East River Mountain. The view has never gotten boring. Sometimes I get tired of seeing it all white on top, and I say, please turn green. But that's always been there. I'm from a town in Tennessee about the size of Princeton. And by the way, Dr. Moyer, you need to know that when I was a seminary student, I had campus police called on me 6 times because they thought I did not belong on campus. And it got to be a game and a mark of pride. And I'm still the only one in history that happened to. One of the things I tried to do for years, you know, I went to college in East Tennessee, in Dayton, Tennessee, and we had a lot of students from other places, Florida, those cold lands up north, like Minnesota, Michigan, Vermont, places like that. People from all over the country, including a girl with brown eyes from the Bahamas, whom I married 4 years later. That has an advantage when I go see my mother-in-law. I get to go to a little island in the Caribbean, but I'm related to everyone there, so it's a mixed bag at times. But one of the things I found I had to do was change the way I talk. And you still have not heard my accent at all. You think you have, but you haven't. If you like King of the Hill, I sound like Boomhauer. I'll tell you what, you know. And I remember consciously trying to be something else. Later on as a seminary student, I'm surrounded by all these perfect people who seem to like to wear coats and ties. I don't even tuck my shirt in most of the days, and that's okay. There's a reason I started Blue Jeans and Bands. It's so I can dress like this and get paid for it and have a concert. And it's been a wonderful experience every time. For many years, I tried to pretend to be something other than a kid from a log cabin in Tennessee and a third-generation mediocre banjo player. And one of the wonderful things about being here is Bluefield College has embraced what it means to be Appalachian. We started an Appalachian festival for the primary purpose of letting those of us that are from the hills show those of you that ain't from here why we like it and why we say the word ain't and we don't care if you don't like it. That's part of what's here. One of the writers that the School of Education, one of the professors there told me about, the writer said, I carry my history in my mouth. And that made me feel so much better. Anyone that knows me knows that I have lived in Tennessee and in New Orleans, which is a big shock coming from a small town, then the swamps of South Carolina. I served a place called Great Swamp Baptist Church. Run over rattlesnakes every day on the way to work. And then to back to Tennessee again, and then to Louisville, Kentucky, to Southern Seminary to do my DMA, and then desperately hoping for a job and applying for a job at Bluefield College, and they said, we're going to hire a local guy. Dr. Necessary. And I thought, oh, nuts, that would have been perfect. And then 2 years later, an email came from a guy named Bryant Moxley to Doug Smith, my professor, at like 7:30 in the morning. And about 7:45, he sent the email to me, and about 7:46, my resume was back in the inbox at that place called Bluefield College, because I wanted to teach at a small Christian liberal arts college in a rural area in Appalachia, and I stepped in it up to my eyeballs. And it's been great. Now, there any job worth having,
will have days you want to pick up a hammer and throw it through a window. I hope that's a natural human emotion. It's probably accurate. I've never done that here. But the coolest thing, I wanted a place where I could replicate my college experience. And when I was a student at Bryan College down in Dayton, Tennessee, I had professors that if I didn't understand something, I could go to them and say, hey, I don't get it. I could be failing a test on a Friday, and on Saturday I could be hiking up on the mountain with them or watching movies at their house. I had professors that would go eat food with me. And some of you are starting to see why I do the things I do. The central core of a college is one thing, and one thing only, and those are the students. Not the professors, not their research agendas, not administration, not politics, not marketing, not anything like that. It's the individual sinners just like me who need redemption and a calling in life, and it's our job to help them find that calling, plain and simple. Students are the center of all of this. But in the midst of all of that, I still am the kid from Tennessee, the third generation mediocre banjo player. So what did I do for my quarantine project? I did not paint the house. I wrote country music and Jimmy Buffett sound and stuff, and I recorded it, and nobody listens to it, and that's okay, because it's for me. My wife listens to it, and like two other people, and that's okay, but Vince approached me about doing one of my songs called Any Road Home. I'll take any road that gets me back home, just give me the word to go, and I'll live out my life there on the Barren Fork, that's the river. They're in the shadows of Ben Lomond, and Ben Lomond is not a person. Ben is the Scots Gaelic word for mountain, because the Scots Irish saw the mountain outside my hometown and said, that looks like Ben Lomond back there outside Edinburgh or wherever. And so they named it Ben Lomond. Now, this is the jazz band, but they're not playing jazz now, so we're augmenting them with some assistance. Whichever one gets up here first. Okay. Lily Comer, yay! Y'all clap. Now, you need to know that Lily makes more money performing music than the music faculty make performing music. We make our living teaching, but Lily is out singing country gigs, what, two or three times a week?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you were in a competition recently where?
I was at Old Red back in February.
In Gatlinburg?
Gatlinburg, yeah.
Owned by what's-his-face?
Blake Shelton.
Yeah. And did you win?
I won the first round.
The first round?
Yeah.
You didn't win the grand prize, did you?
No, but I still get to play there, so.
But she still gets to play at Old Reds in Gatlinburg. And she has, every week, if you look at her Facebook page, you go, when does she sleep?
Never.
Now, we wonder the same thing occasionally, looking at her in class, she's asleep. But she is out making music and letting people know who she is and telling her story through songs. So look her up. Don't you have a website, Lily?
Yes.
What is it?
LilyComer.com.
Shocking.
Yeah, it's pretty simple.
So be sure and look that up and follow her career, because I hope one of these days when I'm in Tennessee, I'll look up and go, holy cow, I know her. I bet I can get an autograph. Probably won't, but I bet I can. Then there's Alandra right here. Alandra, yay. I used to use Alandra to scare some of our students. They would say, Dr. Priest, why does everybody carry a knife here? And I'd say, Alandra, can I borrow your pocket knife? And she would pull out this big pig sticker. If you don't know what that is, you ain't from around here, okay? And it was just kind of fun to scare some of the gentler souls. But one of the wonderful things about Alandra is she is our collaborative artist, which means she's the piano player for everybody. And without her, we would have to lock the doors on this building most days, because she is our staff accompanist, and she is as much a part of the leadership of this department as the faculty are, so her voice counts equally. But she is also a versatile musician. She doesn't just play gentle Mozart and stuff like that. When you make her mad, you really hear the West Virginia come out in her voice, don't you? And you do it deliberately, too, because you know that gets their attention. But she can also sing mountain music and play fiddle. So tonight she is a fiddle player. We're going to close with Any Road Home. With any luck, I'll remember the third verse. Even though I wrote it, occasionally I forget it. Let's see what happens. Hope and highways lead away from town. Finish school, then hit the road. Find your fortune far away from everything you've ever known. The far horizon never seems to end. One more mile is never enough. Maybe one day I'll see Tennessee, the only place I've ever loved. I'll take any road that gets me back home. Just give me the word to go, and I'll live out my life there on the barren fork. There in the shadow of Ben Lomond. I hope this highway leads me back to town. I've been too long on this road. Maybe this time I'll come back home to stay. I wonder why I ever roam from people that walk like me and talk like me. County fairs and a marching band. Now that I've come back home, I'll never roam again. I've found my place to stand. I'll take any road that gets me back home. Just give me the word to go, and I'll live out my life there on the barren fork. There in the shadow of Ben Lomond. See, that's a conductor trick we do. In a minute, we're going to have some cake back here. I want every student that I've ever had, even if you failed the class, I don't care, to come right down here, and we want to get a picture together. I do want to tell you, Saturday night is the choir concert in here at 7:30 p.m. led by Dr. Moyer. So please come and hear variations. Okay, you ready? Everyone break!